We welcome you today to our worship service. We are here at Colby United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Sheila.
And I'm Pastor Daniel from Auburn First United Methodist Church.
And we are so glad that you have come to worship today. Would you join us in the call to worship? Love one another, even when love involves risk.
We love as God loved us.
Love and care for others, even when caring is hard.
We love and care as God loves and cares for us.
Love in truth and action.
By this we are known as children of God.
Let us pray. Shepherd of love, guide our thoughts and our actions that we too might become shepherds of love. Speak to our hearts as we listen this day, that our hearts may expand and embrace all of your sheep. Love us fully, that we might love all the flocks of your world, as fully as we are loved by you. In your shepherding love we pray. Amen.
One, two, three, four.
Done for me. Hello, I'm Allison. I'm a member of Colby United Methodist Church. The scripture I'm reading today is John 10, 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. When the hired hand sees the wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. That's because he isn't the shepherd. The sheep aren't really his, so the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. He's only a hired hand, and the sheep don't matter to him. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and they know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. I give up my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that don't belong to this sheep pen. I must lead them too. They will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock with one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me. I give up my life so that I can take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I give it up because I want to. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it up again. I received this commandment from my Father. The second scripture is 1 John 3:16 through 17. This is how we know love. Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. But if someone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but refuses to help, how can the love of God dwell in a person like that? This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
How many of you have had pets? Well, I've had quite a few in my lifetime. I now have two cats and a dog, Lily, Annabelle, and Katie. This is Katie. All of our animals have come to us in different ways, and they all have needed a good home, otherwise they would have been in real trouble. Lily we adopted at the Humane Society event in Bothell 14 years ago when she was only a year old. We got her as a companion dog for my son who has autism to teach him responsibility and empathy and how to care for someone else, which is sometimes difficult for people with autism. She's 15 years old now, and she's still going strong. She's a dog who loves to go for a ride in the car or take a walk. She's the best dog I've ever had. Then there's Annabelle. Now, she's the newest to our family. We haven't even had her for a year yet. She needed to find a new home after her family split up due to divorce and was given to us. She came with absolutely no history, and we really didn't know how she would do in our home. I'm happy to say she's finally settling in, but it has taken her some time, and she still doesn't like to be picked up. However, she now sits on our laps, and she loves to play with her laser toy and her catnip. She loves to watch the hummingbirds, and she even makes a funny little chirping noise when she sees them on the feeder. One of the difficulties we have with Annabelle is that our cat Katie, this one, really doesn't like her. Katie hisses at Annabelle and doesn't want to be near her at all. Katie came to us after my mother died. She was her cat and was used to being the only animal in the house. She was so spoiled and always given lots of attention and special food. Katie has a very loud purr, you may be able to hear it, and it is getting quite old now, and she's completely deaf. She had repeated ear infections, and it just affected her hearing over time. She sleeps a lot, and we estimate her age to be around 15 also. We've had her now for about 5 years, and she's definitely my husband's cat. No doubt. She likes the rest of us, but she loves him, and he loves her back. All of our animals require special care. We have to feed them and give them medication, clean out the cat boxes, take the dog for a walk, play with the cats and the dog, keep them apart when they fight, give them love and a comfy place to sleep, and keep them clean. We love them, and so we do what we need to care for them. God is like that. God knows we need love and gives it to us in many ways. By, first of all, giving us this gorgeous earth that we live on. and also by giving us opportunities to help each other and care for those that need extra help. Also, by sending Jesus to us to show us how to love and care for each other. We love it when our pets show us affection, don't we? When they purr, or when they jump up on your lap or lick your face. It's their way of showing their love to us. How do we show our love to God, I wonder? Well, one way is to be kind to each other and treat each person as God would treat them, like the treasure and loved person that they are, just as they are. I hope you will try to find ways this week to show God's love. Let's pray together. This is a repeat after me prayer. Loving God, help us to remember how Jesus taught us to love. Love each other, love ourselves, and especially to love you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all the people said, Amen. Isn't that right, Katie? Well, I guess it's time for Katie and I to go. We'll see you next time. Bye.
Today, the title of our sermon is Listen to My Voice, and it comes from John chapter 10.
I don't know if you've ever thought about this. I think we've talked about it before, but I always think it's funny that Scripture speaks of believers of Christ with this analogy about us being sheep.
Yeah, it is kind of funny because sheep have this reputation for not being the smartest of animals. And they're also defenseless. If you think about it, they don't have horns or talons or sharp teeth to defend themselves.
They got nothing except a shepherd. And I think that to some degree that's why Jesus maybe likes to use that analogy of the shepherd needing to care for the sheep. And there are four major things. We're going to kind of bookend them together, but there's really four things that Jesus says to his disciples.
He starts by saying, I am the good shepherd. And then goes on to say that he is willing to lay down his life for his sheep.
The third thing he says is, my sheep know me, and the implication is he knows them, and he says, I have sheep in another pen, and then I'm bookending that again with, I am the good shepherd, because it just seems like it goes together just really well. So we're going to kind of talk about those four things.
So Jesus is speaking this, it's written in the first person. He says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd means that he is one who is always looking out for those under his care. He's taking care of them, and we may interpret this as Jesus intended it, that he's not talking about sheep literally, he's talking about his people, his followers. And you know, you might think of it in terms of today where people say, I found my peeps, and that's the sort of thing that Jesus is talking about.
The second thing that Jesus says is, I'm willing to lay down my life for my sheep. And that's Jesus's way of telling his disciples and his audience that he really cares deeply about his followers, and that he is willing to die for them, and he showed that in the crucifixion and the resurrection. But it was just a way of telling them that this wasn't a passing thing, that he would love them for the long haul.
Jesus also says, my sheep know me. There's this recognition that his followers have that he is there for them. He'll take care of them. And there's also this sense that just as a flock stays together, his followers belong together and know that they're loved and know that they matter to him.
And then we get to the complicated one, which Jesus says, I have sheep in another pen. And this is just kind of a really interesting thought, because first of all, it's this one sentence that's stuck in the middle of this dialogue that sort of gets us a little, I don't know, confused possibly.
Yeah, we wonder, what did he mean there?
Right, and there's no explanation. There's nothing before it or after it that really sort of addresses that one line.
There's no elaboration on that idea of there are other sheep.
So we think, well, he could just simply be referring to the fact that he's with the Jewish men in the Jewish community. He was born as a Jewish man. And maybe he's just saying, I have this other flock, which are the Gentiles. That's the easiest translation, and it's pretty easy because as we look at the rest of the Gospels and the rest of the letters, we see Paul and Peter reaching out to the Gentiles, and there's kind of a big...
That was a big deal.
It was a conflict.
Mm, yeah. It could also refer to other nations, like the Samaritans, who were kind of Jewish, but they weren't considered Jewish enough. And the surrounding nations that had been their enemies. Was Jesus alluding to the fact that he was for these nations too?
Mm-hmm. And could it be even other religions? And that's one that a lot of people struggle with. Is Jesus sort of land bound to this thing that we call Christianity? And the reality that we're tethered to both the Muslim and the Jews because we have the same roots, we are the same family.
Mm-hmm. And you know, it's interesting that Jesus never used the word Christian.
Right.
That was a term that came
afterwards.
Him.
Yeah.
Could Jesus be alluding to other people that the Jewish people considered unclean and therefore unfit to be a part of the faith.
Or we could just as easily say, could it be that Jesus was talking in a future tense in such a way to address that his believers would also, like we do now in the modern world, sometimes have traditional views about what it means to be a Christian and who can be a Christian. And we too see certain people as unfit, unable to be, or we will not let them be a part of the family. Mm-hmm. And then we bookend this with, I am the Good Shepherd, because I think that that's really important to bookend these conversations with the understanding that Jesus was really honing in on his kindness to humanity.
So even though this is written in the first person and Jesus is using himself as an illustration, I think that we need to consider how Jesus being in that role of the Good Shepherd is a model for us.
Right, and part of that is because it seems like all of Jesus' teaching wasn't meant to just be here. It was definitely some head teaching, but it was some heart too. So we always have to ask the question, what is that asking us to do?
Mm-hmm. So, let's go through these verses and see how they may apply to us today. When Jesus says, I am the Good Shepherd, it can mean that we are also called to be good shepherds and care for those around us. That we are to be on the lookout for those who need that special touch, that special attention and care.
Maybe those who need a little bit of protection.
Yeah. And I remember also the scripture that talked about Jesus leaving the 99 to go look for the one that was lost and hurting. Maybe we are to give that extra attention to those who really need that extra care.
When Jesus says, I'm willing to lay down my life for my sheep, I don't think Jesus is then asking us to lay down our lives. But I do think that what Jesus is inviting us to do is to be willing to do something for each other. And sometimes it's something significant and sometimes it's something small. It's that phone call or that financial assistance. We see that in the scripture that, mm-hmm. that we also share today, where it says that it's not right for us not to help each other in the Christian family.
Right, so I think that idea of laying down his life for us could be seen as us being willing to make sacrifices for others. Sometimes those sacrifices are small and we hardly notice that it's taking time and energy. Sometimes the sacrifices are significant, but be willing to be open to helping people and care for them.
It says that Jesus said, my sheep know me. And maybe that's an invitation for us to get to know each other and care for each other in better ways, because the more we have a sense of who we are, the more we can care for one another. And I realize I'm talking during a COVID shutdown still, but I do envision a day where we will sit around tables and ask, how is it with your soul? Mm. And what can we do and how can we help you? And I think that that's the knowing part that's important.
When Jesus said, I have sheep in another pen, I think that that's an invitation for us to understand that we are not the chosen few. We should be careful not to think of ourselves as an exclusive club, but rather we need to open our arms and our hearts to try to be more inclusive, to reach out to those who need to be cared for, need to find a spiritual home, need to find a place of community.
Even when they don't look like us or talk like us or...
Or maybe not even believe like us.
Exactly. So we bookend again, as I said, with I am the Good Shepherd. I think it's just an invitation to be good to each other. So... The point is this. Jesus says, I'm the Good Shepherd, inviting us to be good caretakers of each other, and maybe even good caretakers of the planet, because, you know, this is the time where we think about the beauty of the earth. Mm.
Jesus also invites us to be more inclusive, to recognize that there are others outside of the traditional boundaries of
church
and Christianity
that need to be welcomed and need to feel the touch of compassion and care.
And it might be the homeless. It might be someone in great need, emotionally, connectionally, financially.
It may be our neighbor. It might be our neighbor quite literally. It might be our neighbor in a more figurative sense. Just someone else in the neighborhood, in the area, whether near or far.
It may be someone who's going through some real brokenness at this time. Maybe they're feeling like they are outsiders and nobody has reached out to make them feel their humanity. It might be people struggling with mental health or drug addiction.
I think that we need to be very careful not to put Jesus in a box.
Mm-hmm.
We need to open up those boundaries that have kept us into thinking of things in a very traditional way.
This is our stuff.
This is the way we do it.
Yeah.
And we need to allow for more inclusive, a more inclusive welcome into our churches.
Yeah, more interactions. The message titled for today was Listen to My Voice. And if I were to take that title, I guess what I would say is Jesus calls us to listen to His voice, which reminds us that we are to be good, kind shepherds to each other. And that maybe the best way we represent Christ is by being good to one another.
Amen.
Hi, please join us for We Will Follow.
You're the way, you're the truth, you're
We've been talking about the shepherd today, and one of the things that the shepherd does is it cares for the sheep. And in some ways, we too shepherd each other and care for one another. And we do it with phone calls, and we do it with cards, and we do it with visits when it's appropriate. And we do it also with the way we support the ministries of the church. And we come back to these colorful cards as we shepherd one another in ministry and service. Would you pray with me? Shepherd of love, bless these gifts with the power and presence of your love. May your love bring healing to a world in need of your touch. May your grace bring hope to a world in need of your promise. And may our love be a sign for all to see that you, who are love, are present in the world today. Amen.
Hi, I'm Diane Bishop, chairperson of the Colby Staff Parish Relations Committee. As you know, we've been looking for a pastor for the past few months, and the decision has been made, and this is our letter from our district superintendent, Mark Gallag. To our siblings at Colby United Methodist Church, grace to you, peace from God, our Creator, and Christ our Savior. I'm writing this letter to share with you that Bishop Elaine Stanowski intends to appoint the Reverend Carolyn Bowers as pastor of Colby United Methodist Church, effective 1 July 2021. Reverend Bowers is an ordained elder and a full member of the Oregon-Idaho Conference. From 1997 to 2006, she has served as a pastor of Faith Redeemer, Clackestine United Methodist Churches in Oregon, as well as Middleton First, Wilder, and Jason Lee Memorial to be closer to David's family. That's her husband, David. In Iowa, Pastor Carolyn served as pastor of Trinity UMC and Oakland UMC. That's her current appointment right now. I also pray God's grace and abundant blessing on your pastor, the Reverend Sheila Miranda, and her family, especially during this time of transition. Kindly join me in thanking Pastor Sheila for her faithful service to the church and to the greater community. May the Holy Spirit continue to enliven and guide your lives and ministries so you can become the radically welcoming and loving faith community that you have always meant to be. Your fellow disciple, Reverend J. Markle Mark Gallag, District Superintendent.
Good morning, I'm Jeannie Monroe, lay leader, and my task today is to give you a kind of a snapshot of what we on the SPR committee were able to see in our new pastor, Carolyn. She comes to us with a number of years of experience. She is a gracious woman who represents probably the kind of person that we would enjoy having in our community. She is active in her faith community and in her community at large in Iowa, and is anxious to move back out to the Pacific Northwest to be around her family and to be able to continue her faith journey with our faith journey. She was born in Alaska and lived in Alaska for a period of time. She's lived in all four of the states in the Pacific Northwest, so she's very familiar with our community. She is able to articulate an interest in being active in the community that we serve. She's anxious to do that. She has done things like be a chaplain in the jail, the county jail in Iowa. She is actively involved in continuing her learning experiences and her education, and I think will encourage us to be able to do that kind of thing as a congregation. Most importantly, though, I think, is that she brings to us a very calm and personable demeanor. She is a cat person. She loves cats. She has three of them. She loves all animals, actually, she said. And her husband was raised on a farm, so the activities in this community will suit them. As far as getting to know her, she is very actively anxious to get to know us, and asks a number of questions about how, during this pandemic situation, she was going to be able to greet us individually and learn about who we are as individuals in this congregation. So I personally and the members of the committee felt very comfortable with the appointment of Pastor Carolyn to the Colby United Methodist Church.
As we bring our service to a close, we are asking for prayers for many families who are really struggling with heavy emotional pains, losses, grief, people struggling with cancer and treatments, with parents, with relatives who are sick. And we just need to remember that maybe your life and mine might be doing okay now, but someone in our family, you may know them, you may not, is really struggling. And so keep them in your prayers.
Mm-hmm. We just ask that you take the opportunity to encourage them if you have friends in that category. We also just want to remind you that we have celebrated Earth Day this past week. And even though Earth Day is past, every day is a good opportunity to take care of our Earth. It is just a beautiful time of year. The trees and the flowers are bursting forth in bloom. And we encourage you to take note of that. Appreciate it. Thank God for the beautiful world that we have been given. And take the opportunity to be outside and enjoying all of God's beauty. Let us now receive our closing benediction. Let us love, not just in words, but with our very lives. When we love in truth and action, we show God's love to the world. Christ, the Good Shepherd, can love through us when we love with deeds and lives. Go now to love in truth and action. By this we are known as children of God. Amen.